Flight 10 went very well, but there were some serious consequences. Shortly after launch, a major issue arose with the booster's quick disconnect system. This system is responsible for refueling and connecting the boosters. This has been a major issue for SpaceX engineers and may delay Flight 11 by a month. What happened and how will SpaceX fix it? Let's discuss it all in today's episode of NR Studio. Congratulations to SpaceX. To achieve good results and collect useful data from Flight 10, they had to work hard. They ensured the flight remained on time and very accurate. This is all thanks to the highly skilled engineers and experts Elon Musk assembled. Looking back from Flight 9 to Flight 10, it was not an easy journey. The flight was scheduled for late June. The explosion of Ship 36 at the Massey site caused a major delay, lasting almost 2 months. While waiting, SpaceX worked hard to repair the test area at the Massey site, spending millions of dollars on repairs. At the same time, their engineers were meeting to plan changes to the BQD on the OLM-1 pad. These changes were necessary to properly connect to the Starship upper stage and conduct a static test firing. And it felt like we had been waiting for a whole year. Flight 10, which was supposed to take off on August 24th, was delayed due to issues with the ground system. It was then postponed to August 25th, but bad weather, with large storm clouds, caused another delay. They finally managed to launch on the third try. As the saying goes, third time's luck. In the end, it was thrilling to watch Flight 67 take over and successfully complete all of Flight 66's tasks. While everyone was focused on the vehicle and its recent success, the launch pad, usually overlooked, was facing some major issues. There wasn't much time to celebrate, as SpaceX engineers needed to find a fix for the badly damaged BQD on the OLM. To understand the gravity of the situation, watch this video. Do you see it? Just seconds after launch, all 33 Raptor engines on Booster 16 fired, lifting the booster skyward. Thick steam erupted from the water spray system to protect the launch pad, but the booster's power was too great. The engine generates nearly 7,600 tons of force when running at full power, and the combustion temperature reaches 2,500 degrees Celsius, which is about 4,500 degrees Fahrenheit. The BQD began to retract its arms and its hood closed to protect itself from the intense heat. But it was no use. Moments later, a fierce fire engulfed the BQD, burning so hot that it turned white. With such extensive damage, the fuel lines inside were likely destroyed, and the thin metal hood was no protection from the inside. The QD systems were badly burned, not only on the outside, but also inside. Some parts had cracks and partially melted edges. If a system as powerful as the QD could be damaged this badly, it was natural that the thinner fuel lines and smaller, more distant ground connections might also be affected. Due to the apparent damage, SpaceX may have to make major repairs or replace some parts entirely. This will impact future flights because the launch pad is needed for a crucial step, the static firing test of the booster. This test cannot occur without a functioning QD system. Now let's address the main question for Flight 11. Which vehicle will perform the static firing at the OLM after the BQD is repaired? From what we know, two boosters are expected to be used for Flight 11. The first is Booster 15, which landed safely and was captured by Mechazilla during Flight 8. The second is Booster 17, a new stage. For the next flight, Booster 15 seems like a better choice. On Flight 10, SpaceX gathered important information by pushing the rocket to its limits at a steep angle using Booster 16. This information will help them improve fuel usage for the landing, so they will likely not have to perform the same difficult test again. Booster 15 is a previously used rocket, as was Booster 14, which was used again on Flight 9 to test it. The information gathered from that test helps improve the reusability of the booster. Booster 17 has been sitting in the rocket park unused for over 4 months. There are also reports that it is being held as a backup in case Booster 16 needs to change its course during its 10th flight. Which booster do you think will succeed? B-15 or B-17? Let us know your answer in the comments and we'll see who guesses correctly. I'm going with Bravo 15 with Spacecraft 38 for this mission. Regarding Spacecraft 38, SpaceX appears to be making rapid progress in its preparations. On August 27th, cameras at Starbase showed a crane carrying one of the rear covers to Mega Bay 2. The next day, they also brought in the final cover. The Raptor engines were added to spacecraft 38 in mid-August. This means the last major task remaining is installing the two front covers and completing the heat shield. It appears they will still be conducting cryo tests and static fire tests for spacecraft 38 on the launch pad. The Massey site hasn't just been repaired, it's been significantly upgraded. On August 6th, people noticed that Starship's static fire mounts are getting stronger. Steel beams were added around the new mount and replacement pipes for the flame deflectors were installed nearby. This indicates that the old deflectors were damaged. At the same time, they have begun moving the booster static fire activity to Massey. This means that in the future, they may stop conducting booster static fires on the launch pad. Instead, the site is being upgraded for the version 3 vehicle. Here's an example. On August 21st, they finished installing the new booster quick disconnects for version 3. Seems easy enough, right? However, this means SpaceX will have to repeat the complicated process of removing the booster clamps on the OLM-1 pad. Then they need to install and reinforce the ring wall mounts, which are like benches that hold the U-38 vehicle securely on top. After that, they need to properly stabilize them before testing the vehicle. However, this will most likely only be done after Booster 15 completes its static firing test. Since B-15 is a used vehicle, they won't just be performing a light inspection this time. For that mission, if Booster 15 is in good condition, SpaceX will attempt to capture it with Mechazilla. This would demonstrate that the booster can fly more than once, not just once. It would demonstrate how well the company's initial goal of building a fast, cheap, and safe reusable rocket is being met. What about Starship 38's mission? Will the tower capture it this time? The answer is no. After Starship 10's flight, Elon Musk was very clear. Starship capture is likely to occur during flights 13 to 15, based on how successful the version 3 flight was. The Starship used in flight 10 was a version 2. It's the same size as the upcoming version 3 rocket, but can carry less weight and has a weaker ship and booster. Musk mentioned that there will only be one more V2 flight before the change occurs. Starting next year, the V3 will be the primary model used until 2026. Meanwhile, V4, SpaceX's most advanced design, could be the first Starship to carry humans into orbit. Musk has said that SpaceX plans to attempt to capture the first Starship in 2025. However, it may actually happen in 2026 due to scheduling issues. To stay on schedule, SpaceX needs to complete Flight 11 quickly, Flight 12 by the end of the year, and then aim for Musk's planned Flight 13 capture attempt. This isn't the first time this has happened, but since the company has only completed 3 test flights this year, they need to accelerate their launch schedule. If SpaceX continues at this slow pace, the government may eventually intervene. Why? Because Washington is increasingly interested in owning a piece of defense companies. Each year, the U.S. government spends a lot of money, hundreds of billions, on defense companies. During Trump's term, officials have stated that they want more than just products and services. They want ownership or a stake. In an interview, Commerce Secretary Howard Lutnick said that the Pentagon is considering taking stakes in companies that supply defense goods. He said that current funding for weapons purchases is too limited and needs to be reconsidered. The suggestion that the government might consider investing in Intel surprised many analysts. Major defense companies are strong enough to resist such demands. For a fast-growing private company like SpaceX, greater government control could spark a dispute, something Elon Musk would vehemently oppose. After all, Musk publicly sparred with Trump just a few months ago. Unlike struggling companies like Intel or MP Materials, which must sell shares to raise government funds, SpaceX and other leading defense companies are financially sound. Boeing raised $24 billion by selling shares last year. In June, as Musk's relationship with Trump soured, former White House advisor Steve Bannon suggested using a law called the Defense Production Act to take over SpaceX. That's all for today's episode. See you in the next one.